Last night they had a, I suppose you'd call it a documentary of sorts, on, I think it was the Discovery Channel. And they were talking about how a lot of people move around the South Pacific in the smaller non-passenger ships. Well, I beg to differ a bit on that. A few do, but it's always been very draconian, the rules. In about 1920, somewhere like that, the rule came in that if you had more than 55 souls on board, you had to have a doctor. Big expense, nobody wanted that. So that meant that cargo ships, which in those days had rather large crews, had to skip taking any passengers at all. Then the rule came in that women unaccompanied couldn't travel in cargo ships or tramp ships or whatever you want to call them. And that was a shame because there were some very clever men and women out there who wanted to move around the island, not with a lot of yahooing riff-raff throwing beer down their throats around them, but to sit and read and learn and visit the places for what they are, not for the souvenir shops. Going back, I think it was 1973, I suppose, there was a lot of aggro between the two Samoas. Now, I don't know if you know or not, because it never makes the news. There were two Samoas. There was Western Samoa and American Samoa. And the two capital cities actually on different islands, but they were only about 100 nautical miles apart. And they sat just the other side of the date mine, so you're looking at about a 400-mile steaming distance from Nuku'alofa. The problems began when it started to get pushy about the administration of the islands. American Samoa was always American. Once they get their toe in the door, you don't get them out. And the capital, of course, you've probably heard of, Pango Pango. The other one, Western Samoa, was more, as the name perceived, the culture was more softly European. A lot of British influence, a lot of British. And their capital was Apia, or Apia, whichever way you want to pronounce it. Well, these two countries, they were fighting and arguing for, 100 years, I suppose. Western Samoa, as it was then, had German influence, British influence, New Zealand influence, across the board. Everybody had their toe in the door and got a bit confused. There was a big difference in the islands, though, the way that they were run. Western Samoa was neat, tidy, orderly, very low crime rates. The police were modelled on the British police. American Samoa, on the other hand, was always tatty. It always Pango Pango is a beautiful city, don't get me wrong. And when it's tarted up, it's very, very presentable. And I believe that they have cleaned up the whole thing quite recently. Anyway, things came to a head, I think, in about 60, well, between 67 and 70. I don't know, the old brain's not working too well. And Western Samoa decided to just become Samoa. Get rid of the western part. And they did one other thing. The date line goes right down in a straight line and the two Samoas were that side, and Tonga, right down to Australia and around, were on the other side. And it got to the stage where, well, it's a pain in the neck for navigation. What Samoa did was they took that date line as if it was an elastic band and pulled it sideways. So between Western Samoa and, between Samoa and American Samoa, you now had a date line which indicated that 100 miles or 50 miles that way was Samoa and 50 miles that way was American Samoa. And the Yanks went off their little brains about it. A, because they call themselves Samoa, and the Americans thought that that belittled their American Samoa name. It was as if Samoa was the Samoa. Well, actually, it is, because there's two big islands, and Apia's on Opalu Island, and Pango Pango's on Tuatilu Island. But Samoa itself was much bigger. Much bigger. The fact of the matter is that the Yanks were really ticked off, because that meant that that Samoa was 23 hours ahead of them. And that meant a lot in trading. Well, plus they're just naturally mean, nasty people, and don't like other people being more progressive than they are. Anyway, so that was the situation out there. Now, when it comes to carrying the odd person, all of the course of the big container ships and the cargo ships that belong to fleets had to follow the rules. No passengers, none at all. The trampers sort of took it as a suggestion rather than a law. And a friend of mine, nice guy, you'd like him, had a ship in Apia. And they got a request to carry a couple of ladies down to Fiji, bypassing Nuku'alofa. And he said, sure, you know, pay the money. But they got to know the rules. That what they did, how they got around it was, you sign them on as supercargo. Now that means that they're a person working on board who isn't part of a regular crew. Entertainers in cruise ships sign on as supercargo. And my friend just happened to have also some seaman's books in his locker, about four dozen actually, blanks. We don't ask questions. And they were ready to be made out and go along with the sign-on papers as supercargo. So the two women turned up actually. Bit of a surprise, they were nuns. Not the black habit type and all the rest of that. Just in little grey skirts, but they had a headdress the same as, I don't know if you remember the way nurses used to have the headdress when there was such a thing as nurses. So they signed on and they had to be given a job. Well, the older one, she helped out in the galley, and the food got a lot better too, believe me. And the younger one, who was smart, but I could never understand people that wanted to follow this line. She took over or invented crew welfare. And she made sure that their clothes were mended, and she actually mended some herself and did all the crew loved it. They were getting good food, they were getting their clothes mended, and they were getting lectures, not on religion, but on literature of all things. This younger one was going on to be in the nunnery library, I don't know what you call it. And they were getting a bit of an education. So, took them on up here, bypassed American Samoa because they're uniform and regulation crazies. Steamed all the way down to Fiji and put them off. And everything was fine. My friend was very, very worried about having them on board, but only for one reason, that there were 20 pallets of whisky sitting in the hold that weren't on the manifest, hence bypassing American Samoa too. They'd done a big drop-off before we got to Apia. The 20 pallets left, always handy to have. You have them down there. A4, it's a currency. Great for bribes with port officials and all the rest of it, especially in some of the smaller islands, especially places like Fiji. Not so much New Caledonia. But the ship was swinging up then to the east again soon after, and we'd be going to, where were we going? Taiwan, Hong Kong, and then up to Shanghai straight away. Used to be Canton, Qingdao, and then up to Shanghai. And they were coming very handy then. The joke that's in it was that, by golly, it was good that those 20 pallets were sitting down there. The older of the two nuns liked a whisky. That's an understatement, she loved a whisky. And when her friends came on board in Suva to help take them ashore and their little bit of luggage, they stayed on board all day. And by 6 o'clock in the evening, 7 o'clock in the evening, they were legless. You ever seen 15 legless nuns pretending that they're not legless? You can get away with it in Sierra. It made them more human, so, yeah, what the heck. But when we checked afterwards, there was still 20 pallets of whiskey. But one of them was short one case. So between them, they got through nearly 12 bottles of whiskey. I don't know what they had it with. We were actually very short, he was very short on splits at the time, you know, the soda waters and all the rest of it. So they'd just been having it with ice and water. The upshot is that the regulation still does apply. The cargo ships won't take just the one or two passengers. So I don't know what they're talking about on this travel thingy. I suppose if enough money is put in enough brown paper bags and slipped here, there and everywhere, you can get on. It's a great way to travel. And they're working during the day, so the crew love having them there. The money that they pay, always very handy, especially with the one-off vessels. No problems whatsoever. I've taken a few myself, but usually I'm with the bigger ships towards the end, where you've got 1,200 passengers milling around, drinking, yahooing, not dressing for dinner, and that's real fun. If ever I got a bit better and could go to sea as a passenger, I wouldn't choose any of the Carnival ships, which includes P&O now and all the rest. I'd go with something like Viking. No casino, no children on board, food that really is food from way back when. Till then, though, oh God, the Americans have really stuffed up that industry. And I don't think the ships still to this day are as safe as they make believe. One thing you always have to remember, I know I shouldn't point being told about that. No matter how glitzy the ship is inside with all the neon lights and the plush carpets and the glitzy bars and the bands playing and all the rest of it, you've got that much steel between you and the elements. That's all. You can be standing there, comfortable, warm, enjoying your drink. Move 4 inches that way, you're as dead as a dodo. Thought I'd leave you on a happy note. That's it. Have fun. Enjoy yourselves. And maybe think about next time you travel, seeing as if you can find a cargo ship to take you somewhere. Might have somebody like me driving it. And we're always a bundle of laughs.